shit's blocking the content.
Yeah. Steve, can you open your video tab a little bit? Steve said John, it's dark in there, man. We're gonna get sun, guys, settle. That's good. There, Steve, you got it done. Excellent. Just call it, guys, we're rolling.
I was using Man on Fire, which is a book that I had read very early in my career, to pitch to other writers for other projects. I was pitching them why this was a great character and we should try to emulate this character in other projects. And at some point I woke up and I realized, you know, I should just make Man on Fire. I should just remake that movie. It's such a great story. I can never duplicate the relationship, the character relationships that I was so interested in. And I was really taken with the book. And when it was the right time, we set out to do that.
Action day!
Fire I wanted to make 22 years ago, and then Italy was the kidnap capital of the world. It's based on a real life character on a true story.
Tony had developed Man on Fire before it was made. When it was originally a book, he had developed it in between his first movie, The Hunger, and his next movie, Top Gun.
I wanted to do it then. And people didn't think I could do it, didn't they? I could handle performance and that's sort of the emotionality of the story.
I was talking to Tony about another project, and he asked me what I was working on, and I said, I'm working on this thing, Man on Fire, and he said, I was the original director of that movie, and I said, you're kidding, you know? I have a script, you should read it.
I got called by Sanford Panich, who works at New Regency, asking me if I would read the book for Man on Fire. He said that to me, and I said, I know that title. But I couldn't place it, and he said it had been made into a film once before with Scott Glenn. And the weird thing was is when I used to live in by LAX, and the video store I used to go to was the one Quentin Tarantino worked at. And one time I was in there when Quentin Tarantino still worked in the video store, and I asked him what was a good movie to rent, and he told me I should watch Man on Fire with Scott Glenn, which is how I had seen the movie in the first place.
We talked about a kind of different version of the movie from the one that I had developed, taking the character but sort of treating it a different way. And Tony had a history of developing scripts and had a mature idea of how he thought these characters should be and whatever, and I had learned some things from developing it as well. So we ended up hiring Brian Helgeland to write what became the greenlit draft of the movie.
I used to just be a screenwriter, but I've switched over to directing, so I don't really write anymore. And he had said that, you know, Tony Scott's going to direct it, and I didn't know Tony, but I was like, I'm not really in the mood to write for somebody else. And he said, well, just look at it, you know, just read the book, because the book's a lot different than the movie. And I read the book, and I liked the book even more, but I wanted to direct it myself, basically. And Sanford told me that if Tony passed and didn't want to do it, because he had another movie that he was maybe going to do, that they'd put me on as the director. So I don't know if that was a lie or not, but I believed him, and so I wrote the script hoping Tony would say no so that I could direct it. But it didn't work out that way.
The original screenplay was what actually fired me up again. It was by Brian Helgeland, and it was fantastic, but it was set in Italy. But Brian's emotional beats and the structure of the script were fantastic, and the characters are fantastic, but I didn't want to do it in Italy because I felt it was a period piece.
The book was written in the early 70s when kidnapping was a very big deal in Europe and in Italy in particular.
Then the bad guy in the movie was the Godfather, which was he controlled kidnapping in Italy. And in this day and age, kidnapping is, and especially in Mexico and South America, is a huge business.
Tony wanted to bring the story into today's time. It was a story that was apparently a true story that happened in the 70s in Milan in Italy, and it was an American bodyguard who ended up being hired by an Milanese industrialist. If you take a look today at kidnapping in Italy, you'll find there might be five or six in the whole year. Yet in other parts of the world, there's an epidemic.
We knew it was a big issue, and we were looking for a place where culturally it made sense for the story. And we decided, based on some of the true stories that we heard, that Mexico had a kind of an immediacy and a kind of a culture that we in the West can really access. We really identify with it. So we ended up deciding to change the movie to Mexico, even though we had already started to prepare the film in Italy. And we had hired a production designer, and we'd taken photos, and we were scouting. But we made this shift, and it's had a major impact on, I think, the intensity of the story. It just feels like we're in the right place, making the right movie about the right topic at the right time. We did a lot of research to try to get the feeling of real life into the movie, you know, to get that ripped from the headlines, like it's happening now feeling.
The second biggest business in Mexico to drugs is kidnapping. And in our first week there was 26 kidnappings in 1 week.
Unfortunately, although the authorities are doing a wonderful job now, it's been a real problem in this town and in Latin America, but in Mexico in particular. With kidnapping.
It's a horrific crime, and it's an epidemic on top of the fact that the individuals are so violated.
I went with Don Ferrone as my tech advisor. We went down to Mexico, and we found lots of case histories in terms of kidnappings, and we re-engineered our story to accommodate what the real world is like, and we took real characters in the real world and role modeled them for characters in a movie. Don's a guy, he's a rare guy, because normally guys who have been in the agency world, agency being the FBI, the CIA, the DA, all the different worlds, that normally they part ways, but Don, whenever he picks up a phone, these guys respond and are there for him.
We both wanted it to be as accurate as possible, because when we got into the middle of it, what was going on was so spectacular. We ended up at one point discovering that a special squad of police that were sent to the house of the victim, this was an anti-kidnapping squad, and this group was specially trained, had, I believe, trained by the French and trained by the Americans in hostage negotiations, and had all the right equipment, all the right people, everything was right. Well, it turned out that they were consistently ripping off the ransom money.
From the beginning, Tony wanted to make this an incredibly reality-based, true-to-life, based on historical events film. He's taken stories from actual people who have been kidnapped and taken their testimonies and put that into the dialogue in the film. He's met with and researched actual kidnappers to find out their methodology and what they do and how they did it and how they lived and what rooms they lived in.
Where these kidnappers came from, where the Sanchez character came from. You know, it wasn't that he went out to become a kidnapper. He sort of fell into this game of kidnapping people. It wasn't about the money, because they had no concept of that kind of wealth. When they're kidnapping and asking for ransoms of $20 and $30 million, they didn't really know what that was. Sanchez is based on a real kidnapper. When they went into his house, they found $6 million under the sink, soaking wet, because the sink was dripping on them. You know, they had no concept of the money that they had. And the way they dressed, they didn't go out and buy big luxurious houses. All they did was bought a nicer house just around the corner.
I recruited good police from the AFI. We got real bodyguards, real hostage negotiators, spoke with real victims, and spoke with some bad guys.
It's a business which is very organized and very well controlled, and the business of kidnapping, they're divided up into cells. It's like Osama bin Laden, you know, each cell, no cell has connected, so a kidnapping team is divided up into four cells. You have the kidnappers who actually do the abduction, who are ex-cops or corrupt cops, and they just hand them over at a point in time at a location to the guardians. The guardians then look after, you know, put the kids into the safe houses and look after them till, while the deal is being negotiated with the lawyers. Most of the lawyers were American lawyers involved in Mexico.
Sir, this is Mr. Ramos's attorney.
And then there's the guy who engineers the whole thing. And nobody has any numbers on him. He calls them, yeah? They have cell phones and he calls them directly, so they have no way of contacting him. So it's very organized. And the guy who is based upon the bad guy in the movie, it was two brothers, and they made $300 million in 6 years in Mexico City in kidnapping.
I'm just watching what you're doing now, that dictates I'm gonna have you. With this sense of respect, but fuck you.
The villain in the film was modeled after Arizmendi Lopez. He was the head of the ear-cutting gang. The first thing with Arizmendi Lopez was to debrief the prisoner, the person they had. Then they make phone calls, and usually the first phone call to the family, which by the way is also provided by the person they have kidnapped. They get a phone number. They want to know what the mom's name is. They get all this great intelligence. What's your mom's name? What's your dad's name? What's your dog's name? They want to violate the family in the most egregious way. So you can imagine your kid getting kidnapped, and then you get a phone call on your private line. And they ask you about the dog or something like that, but it's usually a very, very vicious phone call, the first one.
Hola. Do you love your daughter, Senor Ramos?
And it's meant to let you know that we've got your kid. Your kid's surviving or not surviving depends completely on you. And boom, hang up the phone. Then the second one comes in and they're a little easier. They say, you know, we want your kid to live, you want to live, we want to make some money. At this point, there's a very interesting philosophy that's floated around. It's called the liberation. It's kind of like a theology. It's almost a Robin Hood kind of mentality, born from the rich being filthy rich and the poor being just with nothing in a lot of these countries. And the liberation philosophy, when taken one step more, just a little step more, breeds this type of kidnapper who believes, you got too much money, I'm going to take it from you. Arizmendi Lopez said that. He called up and said, you know, you got too much money, I'm taking it.
I met a woman who got her child back. I mean, her daughter was actually like 23 or something at the time that she was kidnapped.
She was picked up, her ears were cut off. They were sent back to the family. The family had a plastic surgeon standing by, put her ears in the refrigerator.
They sent her the ears in a plastic bag, and they're like, if you don't give us the money, and this is after they'd already given the money, and the cops had stolen it. So they wanted more money, and basically after they mortgage everything they owned.
They were able to send medicine back to her to put on her ears. When she was ultimately released, the family was in turmoil, and she calmed everybody down because she was standing there with no ears. And through some spectacular work by Mexican plastic surgeons, she has two great-looking ears to this day that were apparently generated off the tissue from the ears that the family had saved. The substance of these scenes has been actually reduced down. A lot of the violence and a lot of the things they did during captivity, you're not going to see. They take people, strip them down, take a little kid, little girl, strip them down, and chain them to a toilet, and leave them in there for months while they're negotiating.
Mr. Ramos, you betrayed me. You killed my nephew. You took my money.
Señor Ramos.
Que Dios se apiade de su hija.
We always use technical advisors. It's very important to us. We've hired a security company that's sort of securing the production while we're here. And one of the things we've also done is consult the guy that we've used, Michael Sapelsa and Avi Corinne. We've consulted them on some of the same issues, you know, basically getting Denzel and Christopher Walken to understand how these people think, act, talk, sleep, eat, you know, feel, what they sacrifice, you know, just who they are.
and no one's going to survive there.
We hired this guy, Don Roche, to essentially train us in how they conduct themselves. How do executive protection experts conduct themselves? What do they think? What's their philosophy? How do they shoot? How do they scan for potential? What's route planning? You know, all of these things which we've put in the movie.
We got 6 shots in 1.7 seconds.
How much?
1.7.
Yeah.
He actually started his life in the Marines, and then he was bodyguarding Schwarzkopf. And then he set up a whole operation that trains bodyguards to go to South America to look after the president of Afghanistan, to look after the Prince of Dubai.
Don came and trained some of my men in a very high-risk group that I had while I was still a federal agent. I took Tony to meet him up in his training facility up in West Virginia.
All you do is put the tip of that orange triangle on the on wherever you want to hit. So no one's going to survive that. Mm-hmm. So there's 2 adversaries, I even did it faster.
1.7.
See, that's amazing.
Don is an expert at what they call close quarter combat. And in law enforcement, the type that I was exposed to, most gun battles happen in under 7 feet.
The law enforcement thing, it's
7 feet.
7 feet, right?
That's a DEA.
About 7 feet.
Yeah.
Well, that
right now. That's why I was trying to talk to you about how we do these things. Do them in close and really fast, and they're over.
Yeah.
They're over, people are down.
He also does a lot of personal security training, which involves high-performance vehicles. And I say defensive driving. It's not defensive driving in the way we know it. It's really high-risk. They call it car fighting.
Now I got it.
I enjoy people pulling out in front of me or doing certain things, but then now I can react and make sure that I'm mentally aware. It becomes, again, a subconscious way that you draw. It's an entire lifestyle change.
Take him off, stay on the traction, break away and go.
Holy smokes.
How do you escape a well-thought-out ambush? How do you survive attack from multiple targets?
I trained with a gentleman by the name of Don Roche, who trains everybody, FBI guys, CIA guys, and personal protection and all kinds of stuff. So he taught me a technique of firing weapons and protection.
Denzel went to Virginia and spent like 10 days with this guy, learning the tradecraft. And it's, whether we use it in the movie or not, it's just good. It's a good mindset for these characters, for these actors, to know what the world is about.
Here we go. There's 100% hits.
When I talked to Tony about the character and the book and sort of who could play it, it was a really short list of names of people that we thought had the range to do it. You have this guy who is, on the one hand, an incredibly violent guy who doesn't say a lot. He's very closed off. He nevertheless has to give a performance while not saying that much. On the other hand, he gets to a place of kind of complete surrender and kind of openness in the middle of the movie. And then he goes back in the second half of the movie, he closes up again and becomes the warrior character.
The obvious answers are Denzel is a great actor. And I love his obsessive quality. I love his darkness. I love it his internal darkness. And I talked to him about it, and he just had a vision which was on the same page as mine.
When I sat down with him, he told me the 20 some odd year story of his connection with the material, and it was a film he wanted to make after The Hunger. a film that I really enjoyed. And he said he really wanted to do this film next. And he ended up making a little film called Top Gun and got off the path.
What I like about Denzel in the part is that there's a hardness in him that I think is really interesting. And it's not a meanness, but it's a kind of a hardness of closing himself off, and I think a defense mechanism against the world that works really well for the character. He knows how to draw it out and use it in a really good way, so that when he shows the humanity, it's a great contrast.
And I thought about other people, and in the end, I always take a long time over all my cast, not just my leads, but, you know, most of all, Denzel's commitment to a role, you know, he became the character as he did, and I worked with him once before on Crimson Tide, and I watched his process, and I watched how committed he becomes, and how hardworking he is, and he becomes the character.
There was a quote I read, I think it was in a book, I'm gonna misquote it, but it was something like, one of the casualties of war is numbness of the heart, you know, he had lost his ability to feel. We sort of developed the ideas as we went along. I mean, the core idea of the story was there, but I actually, when I was working on Training Day, I worked with some cops out of San Francisco, and one in particular had given me a quote from the Bible, Romans chapter 12. And that was something that I mentioned to Tony when we were sitting down, and he really liked the ideas.
The Bible says, be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good.
It sort of infused this spiritual journey that this man takes. I think by being on the road for so long and so many different countries doing these operations, he had lost his wife and really never raised his children. And he never really wanted to get close to anyone because he's seen what death can do, and so he wouldn't make friends. He, especially in children, you know, as he says, the weakest suffer the most.
The first half of the movie is a love story. It's a guy finding his way, and he finds his way through this little thing, this little nine-year-old, yeah? And it becomes a father-daughter love story, and then life changes, as life does. It's like you're in a car wreck, you're on a 10, and things are cruising in the right direction, and you have a humongous car wreck, and all of a sudden you're crippled, and your life changes. And so that's the sort of effect of this kidnapping. He's mentally crippled.
Now, eye blinks and stuff are great.
Huh?
Eye blinks. It's like you can see that there's those blinks.
We're looping the pitas too, because I'm saying pita the whole time.
Damn. Right in here.
Yeah, I'm just saying pita.
When this girl is taken away from him, you know, he had, I think, just closed his heart to love, and he opened it enough for this little girl to come in and to, you know, become a part of his life. And as soon as he's open, she snatched away.
I'm gonna show you what you did. You did great.
The reason that Brian's script worked so well was that he took the love aspect, the emotion that you have in terms of a love story between Denzel and Dakota, he took that and substituted in the second half of the movie for this obsession. You go from one powerful form of emotion into another very different form of emotion now. So you never let off the hook.
Pita is a half Mexican girl, and we live in this huge villa, and she's a little girl that loves life and loves, you know, just to do stuff and swimming, and she's just a regular girl, and she's just like a normal girl who wants her parents to love her, and her parents do love her, but they don't spend enough time with her. Why does he have to go away all the time, every week?
Father has a business to run.
She gets used to it, but it's like, why do they have to go away? And why can't they just stay home with me? And then when Creasy comes into her life, it's sort of like he's a second dad to her.
Scream it loudly, here, scream it loudly. And louder, Dakota. And cut it.
In her case, we never considered anybody else seriously. We really felt this is an adult relationship. She's a kid, but they talk about major stuff. They have a relationship that could easily be two adults talking. Tony and I really felt there was nobody else that could pull it off. And we fought very hard to get Dakota into the movie.
How I became involved was I met Tony at a Mel's Diner in California on Sunset, and we had such a fun time. He drove up in his Porsche Carrera with his pink hat on and real short shorts and a vest with everything that you could possibly imagine hanging off of it. Pins, pads, cell phones, a Walkman, everything on it. And he walks up, "Hi, I'm Tony. Very nice to meet you." And we had lunch there and got milkshakes and stuff like that. And I knew I wanted to do it.
I remember when I told my wife that I was gonna meet with her. She's like, "Oh yeah, did you see I Am Sam?" And she knew her whole resume. I'm like, "Oh, okay. Better get my act together. This girl is serious."
Pita, okay, come on. We'll time it out. You gotta block yourself from the sun. You gotta also tie your shoe up.
Oh.
So she's further back.
I'm a prisoner in the blocks until the gunshot sets me free.
Good, good. Don't smile, don't goof around if you wanna win. You wanna win?
Yes.
All right, good luck.
What's up?
Who's here?
Dakota's 9 going on 19. She's got an uncanny understanding of human nature, and it's instinctual. She doesn't have to think about it. You're watching Denzel would improvise or pull and push scenes different ways, and you just watch her. She just go with the flow, you know, there's no inhibitions. She could shift left and shift right at a drop of a hat.
They're both in character off camera. They're both in character being who the characters are, and their relationship mirrors what's going on in the movie. You know, they're testing each other and feeling the relationship out and getting to know each other as we're getting to know them and they're getting to know each other on film.
You did all this action while they're diving.
Okay.
Okay? And then once they've dived in, then you can say your dialogue.
Okay.
Yeah?
He just lets you do it. Like, practically, you get on the set and he says rolling and you just do whatever. He likes to ad-lib a lot, so you just do whatever you feel right. And he told me, like, before we worked, he said, if you feel something's right to do, I'll go with it.
And then you come back and you run back, yeah? So you're looking around, people, help, somebody, help, help me. Looking around for help, and so you run back again, and you come in on this mark here, and you stop here on this blue mark.
Okay.
Okay, then. And then stay, that's there.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna say, yeah. And I'll yell, "Peter," so you stop here. And you're going, "Help," looking around, "Help me, somebody help." There's gunfire, the guys are here, okay. Cool. And then I'll yell, "Peter," and you cross.
And action!
Crazy!
You can kiss him and hug him and do what you want to do, okay? Don't? But it's great what you just did, but I think you can get more physical if you want, okay? You all right?
Yeah.
Damn, you break my heart.
No, thank you. When I had to do like an emotional scene, I think about my goldfish, actually. I had a goldfish named Flounder that died the day before Christmas Eve. And I had had him for 2 years. And he flipped out of his bowl. And that fish was like one of the only pets I've ever had. Loved that fish, loved it. And then it flipped out of its bowl and it died on the counter. And so we buried it in the backyard in a little gold box. And I just thought about burying my little goldfish. And I started crying. It's actually kind of weird, strange actually. I just was thinking about, you know, like what if that was my dad up there that I had to leave and run away. And you know, I started crying and crying and you know, I just thought about really, really sad things and, you know, it just started coming out, just flowing out. And, but I, all those scenes that I've done are learning experiences and different things and learning which ideas help you the most and stuff like that. And I take it to the next project that I do.
All right, your mother's waiting for you. She's right down here on the end of the bridge. Okay, you go home.
Where are you going?
I'm going home too. Go, run.
I play, I guess you'd say Denzel's best friend from a long time ago. In the meantime, I've kind of gotten out of the military business. I'm living in Mexico, doing very well. I have a
wife and child and a security business, and you know, I've made a nice new life for myself. We made a deal to take the world together.
That's right. You're missing a line that she tells.
Okay, well, it's not in the script.
Yeah, it's a script.
Yeah, no, it's okay. So you're gonna say?
I say the painting. The painting.
Okay, okay.
She tells you. And hard cases, Chris. Then you come in with and hard cases. That's what you're talking about.
What do you think of tough cookies?
Tough cookies.
I don't know. It seems better for a kid.
Them. Yeah.
Every day when we do scenes, something new happens. Something that wasn't, you know, necessarily in the script. And that's the way it should be. That's the way I like it. I think that's the way Denzel and Tony like it, too. When things are good on a movie and when things are working good, it's fun. Making movies should be fun. And when they're not, I always worry a little bit. But this has definitely been a lot of fun. And also, creative. You know, we do things every day. We do very interesting things.
Originally, I went to Chris to play the lawyer, and Chris said, no, I want to play the buddy.
I play a lot of, you know, villains and heavies, and this part was, you know, he's sort of a nice guy.
Chris can read the phone book and make you laugh and make it interesting, and he's got such an odd, quirky sense of humor. So all the characters that I cast, I think, are people who have an internal sense of humor.
Can I kiss her? Is it all right, or should
yeah,
I wait?
Yeah,
to?
It's all right.
Oh, wait a minute!
My character Samuel absolutely adores his daughter. Loves her to death, but business takes him away a lot. So, but unfortunately, by the time you meet him in this movie, he's just all over the place because of near bankruptcy and his wife spending all this money, and he has to run back and forth to the United States and just try to keep the business afloat. And by the time you meet him, he's all over the place, but one thing he does is absolutely love his family.
He looks like he's losing not just his lifestyle, he's going to lose the life for his family, for his daughter, for his wife. And his wife is a trophy bride, you know, she's an American trophy bride from Houston, and she's demanding, as we all know, as trophy brides can be.
In a lot of ways, they haven't quite accepted their roles as parents, and they hire nannies and they kind of pass it off a lot. As much as they love their daughter, they're kind of a bit immature. And as the story progresses, she clarifies what she wants out of life and what's important to her and what it means to be a mother. When Dakota is released, and I finally see my child again, that was difficult because there's a lot of buildup. Like, you know, first of all, she's dead, then she's alive, and so there's all this release. So it becomes kind of tiring, I guess, after a while when you're constantly, like, freaking out. Sometimes I do, like, just things to get my breath so that I'm breathing faster, because that's sort of, you know, to suddenly be in a state of shock or whatever, your breath changes, and that's like a physical thing, so I might just do something physically to make that happen.
Action, Rada!
Who's that?
It's Daniel's brother.
I balance Rada, who's this, and Rada's an Aussie, but she's tough, and she's got edges, and she's sexy, and she's dangerous.
Just tell me what you want!
And I balanced Rada with Mark, who feels like he's the guy.
Sorry. Here we go, guys, here we go.
Having a 9-year-old daughter, I use her a lot, you know, I think about her and, you know, what would you do as a dad? How would you feel as a dad? This is the one role that makes me dig deep, you know. This is the first time I play a character that's literally frazzled, you know, and he comes apart at the seams, and trying to keep his relationship together, you know, loving his daughter, hating where he finds himself. And so when playing a character like that, while standing in the middle of a Denzel and Mickey Rourke and Rada Mitchell and Dakota Fanning, you know, you really have to come to play, man, because there's no getting away with nothing.
Action. You have it, man.
You know, it's always difficult when you people say, why did you cast this guy? Why did you cast that guy? You just have, it's a gut instinct. Giancarlo Giannini, you know, was I thought was a great role model for the head of AFI for Manzano, because he's eccentric and he's funny and he's strange and he's odd.
Ma Manzano is a man, very simpatico, molto simpatico. He loves women, he loves to eat, and he is very honest. This is his problem, to be very honest, and surrounded by corruption. It's very simple to work with him, because he used to draw every night, he used to do storyboards. In the morning, you see your script, with a little, you see your face, your movement, and you follow the storyboards, and that's it.
Let's move Giancarlo's mark to his right a little, guys, yeah?
Okay. Any other Sancho?
You need friends who know their way around.
This character is unusually strong for a female character. And as a secondary character, that really is very rare.
Mr. Creasy.
Her intelligence, her, what she actually has to do with the story and how she actually helps the story further itself, all in a way that's really sort of surreptitious, but interesting. And the woman that she's modeled after, I call it, I'm honoring her, because it's really not her specifically, really makes you think, oh, you know, this woman is quite intelligent and very intense and very savvy and really cares about her country and really wants this horrible thing that keeps happening to stop.
Action and drama.
People who are not actors, they think that research is about that you have to go and then be a reporter for a week. You could do that, or you don't. It's not going to make the performance better. What's going to make the performance work is your connection to it.
And it's finding you in this empty apartment, we're tracking from the other end of the apartment through to find you sitting here.
If you don't feel the connection to it, you know, immediately, you're just struggling the entire time. You're just like, up this hill, trying to go, but I just don't feel like a reporter. I just have to be, and it's like, fuck it. Sorry, and it's like, forget it. You have to just jump in and be. And I think that you and Lupita Ramos were victims of this organization.
You get one cheap. I mean, hey, just get one that's...
My relationship with Samuel is really close because his father was my dear best friend. And I have a responsibility to his father and to him to look out for his well-being and his best interests. And so when he gets his head, you know, underwater a little bit, I want to be there for him. Tony and I sort of went through it together because I couldn't get, like, a direct read on it because it's... You can't really read it off the page, so you can... more or less try to turn this character into something that's not so obvious because you're dealing in the world of kidnapping here. And my character is sort of conducting this whole little thing. And there's a lot of evasiveness. There's a lot of evasiveness with the answers that I give or the questions that I ask.
Action, guys.
As bodyguard, if you take a bullet for your employer or somebody.
Well, I'm not being paid to protect Mr. Ramos.
That's a good answer.
And then you got the history of the piece where Mark Anthony's character and his father and I were very tight. And he's sort of like a loose cannon. He's got this great looking wife that he's got to keep happy.
For an American, she sure knows how this country works.
She knows men. She knows you, my little pendejo, my little pubic hair. You better get strong, Samuel, or that pussy's gonna walk all over you.
Too late.
Tony was giving me his cigars to smoke at the table, and they got me high. So that we started laughing while we were talking it, and Tony said, keep doing it that way.
Guys, you got one more in you. Excellent, great, excellent. Mickey, Mark, excellent, guys, really good. Keep good, guys, really good.
And the more cigars they kept giving me, the more I couldn't say a line without laughing, and then he started laughing, and I don't know if Tony will use any of that, but we certainly had a good day.
Born American, she sure knows how this country works.
Excuse me? I'm just suggesting ways that he can keep his life together, keep his wife, and have some money, whether it be, you know, a good way to get it or a bad way to get it. Right now, it's the only way to get it.
Action, Javier.
Gracias. It's like a no-win situation, you know? It's like, you know when you do something and you know, fuck, I'm gonna get caught, I'm gonna get burned, you know? It's like, you sense that shit's gonna go down, you know? So it's, you read this material and you don't know what's gonna happen on the next page. And then you get Tony in there, who every day comes up with a new idea. Like, today's scene would be good, it'd be all right, but the fact that he's doing it on the patio and the veranda with the rain, it helps the ambiance, the whole piece. There's like a heaviness to the piece. You feel like you're sinking.
She's my little girl, Jordan.
Everything's gonna be all right.
I always try and cast into who I believe the people, the actors are at home, who they really are. Let's hone your personality. Let's work you as you are. So it's balancing colors, and I always like to put a red against a black in terms of casting, you know, emotional colors I'm talking about. And I think we got a really wild, interesting cast, and the Mexican cast from the guy who plays the head of the anti-kidnap division, who's corrupt, called Chucho, is amazing. He's got one wonky eye, and he's way overweight.
I'm sorry, I'm really sorry for the girl. It was just business. You know, I'm a professional.
And then the guy who plays the bad guy, Roberto Sosa. It's fantastic, and he's just got a presence, even though you never really get a close look at him.
You will drive around the circle 2 times.
Action!
Okay, take a seat. They respect me. You know why? Because my word is good.
Tony and I like that feeling of the kind of expat community that's here. You know, these odd characters, these like characters who are just a little bit off, but each of whom is doing what they can, you know, to make things better or, in the case of the kidnappers, worse.
I always look at real people in real life doing my research, and you always, when you look at real life, you're always stunned by it. What you imagine they're gonna be, and they aren't, you know? And I'm always stunned how much more interesting they are in real life, because we're so conditioned by television and film and the media to believe this is how people are. When I was in Mexico, I discovered there's a New Mexico that's trying to clean up drug traffic, trying to clean up crime. And I met these guys, these young guys who are dedicated to cleaning up Mexico, and I thought that was what's interesting. So I brought a real life story to the piece. Denzel could barely get from his trailer to his truck. There's so many bodyguards, because they were scared that we were making a movie about kidnapping in the kidnap capital of the world, you know?
The big challenge was to make it in the places where it actually happens. And Mexico City being the monster city that it is, Tony wanted the urban look and the excitement of the city, the color, the sound, everything. And nobody shot a picture in Mexico City for Mexico City of this size and this scope in 50 years.
The American presence down there is a very juicy target. And I did hear that there were threats, and there were times when the chief of the Mexico City police came and visited Tony and his people and let him know that we're hearing some things. So tighten up your security a little bit more.
And a few close calls, really close calls. It's like down, that's like City of God. And we were out one night scouting a location. It's the toughest barrio in Mexico. It's one of the toughest in South America. We're out 11 o'clock at night, and all of a sudden there's 6 kids there's 12 kids and there's four of us and a bodyguard, and then there's 20 kids and they're all shirtless and it's like 11 o'clock at night and they're all on crack or whatever they're on, like, and they surrounded us, yeah. And then all of a sudden out of the woodwork comes these 40, 50 year old Teamsters and stuff, yeah. So our bodyguard pulls out this big nickel plated 45, yeah, and stands in the middle of all these kids and everybody's yelling and there's guns coming out, everybody's pulling guns, yeah. And then the squad car comes up and the cop goes in and tells our guy, it's like a Mexican standoff, tells the guy to see your papers. And our bodyguard, Flavio's looking for his papers and they jump him, yeah. They beat the shit out of him. They beat the shit out of the cop. Yeah? And while all this is going, we managed to get up onto this footbridge, yeah. They beat the shit out of the cop. The cop crawls back to his car and drives off. They get Flavio, they pistol whip him. They put a gun to his head, we're up on the bridge. They pull his t-shirt over his face, knocked his teeth out, broke his cheekbone. And they got a gun to his head and they're threatening to kill him unless we come down. This is a week before we started shooting. And we had four armored vehicles still, not a gun pointed, Uzi point, with shirtless kids at 3 a.m. all on wired on fucking crystal meth, sticking Uzis through the crack in the window.
Initially, when Tony first approached me, we were basically making a movie that was based on a book set in Italy, which was all very exciting because we were all looking forward to going to Italy. Tony then started looking for an alternative backdrop to set the story.
I balanced whether I was going to do it in Brazil, in Rio or Mexico, because Brazil is a huge kidnapping problem.
The first script I read, the action was taking place in Italy. And of course was a visualization a little different to when they decided to come to Mexico.
He went off on a couple of scouts to have a look around and fell in love with Mexico City. He's worked in Mexico a couple of times before, so he sort of knew what he was getting into here.
In terms of visualization, I think it's very, very interesting. You know, it's a country that has amazing look, you know, for this kind of film.
We shot the film here in Mexico City, and it hasn't been, to my knowledge, a major motion picture shot here in a while. So it's, you know, people will see things that they haven't seen before. It's been a real education for me.
Just the setting of Denzel Washington in Mexico City is fascinating. You know, you have a photograph, you're in the Zócalo, the center of Mexico, you put him right in the center, it's like, well, that's an interesting photograph.
The first thing was, you know, to find all the locations that Tony had in mind and we had in the screenplay. So we had scouts scour everywhere, and we checked other cities as well, but Mexico gave us everything we wanted. And as we scouted, we were beginning to realize the kind of monster movie we had to put together in a very unfriendly film city. Not unfriendly because the people didn't want us here, but unfriendly in the sense that the streets are very narrow. We got process trailers going through that, that it's very crowded, so crowd control is very, very difficult.
Momento, momento, peatones, calma, calma.
One of the first things that became very evident working in this congested city was moving around is so difficult. So we in those early days, we ended up having to use helicopter, started scouting by air because the script was so specific about certain things, you know, and we're tapping both extremes. You know, Mexico is the extremes. It's absolute poverty, yet the wealth is just unbelievable. Tony tapped into that very quickly. One of the things that we also saw by air, which you don't see on the ground, is you see these areas are literally side by side. I don't know if it is the biggest city in the world, but it's going to be pretty close to it. And Tony just fell in love with this energy here, the color, the vibrance, everything here.
The old part of the city is like 16th century. It's fantastic, yeah. And then you come out to the barrios, and the barrios are beautiful. We won barrio called Los Arcos because we're banned from Nezer after the bodyguard got slammed. to the studio Vandas from Neza, but we went to Los Arcos, and Neza was beautiful, but it's flat. But Los Arcos, we call it the San Francisco of the barrios, because it's hilly. It could have been Morocco. It could have been Kuwait, and it's fantastic. It's so beautiful in its own strange way. So it's dirty, it's beautiful, it's dark, it's dangerous, it's sexual. And so it was a great backdrop for this movie.
He likes very much to shoot practical locations. We have to do many times, you know, quite a lot of things to adapt the locations to the demandings of the shooting. And sometimes we had to transform practically the location to a new world.
As wherever we can, not walk in locations, but locations that we can do minimal amount of work to for two reasons. One is a budgetary thing. The second is that you're capturing Mexico as it is, for real. And then we would go in and adapt and change depending on the character. With the villa, we stumbled across this incredible house that had been left dormant by this old guy who had been living there, I think alone for, I don't know, 10, 15 years. And he was just this eclectic character. He collected everything, cataloged it all and stored it all. So we had this, we walked into this museum, and it was just heaven sent, really. We actually found it from the air. We was on one of our helicopter scouts, and because we were looking for a particular sort of geographical plan for a swimming pool, a room over a garage or something, and the relationship for that, and bedrooms and such like. And it took about two or three scouts from the air, and then we found it. What we're trying to do here is trying to show the weight and the history of his father, with all the sort of antiques and various artifacts that have been collected from around the world. Within that, we're mixing in some of the sort of more contemporary stuff and the slightly more outrageous, like the leopard skins and the zebra in the pool room and all that kind of stuff. You say that the sort of Latin American eccentricities, you know. We go from this opulent upper class, the sort of Las Lomas areas of and the wealthy areas of Mexico. We suddenly start delving into the, I won't say real Mexico, because it's all real Mexico City, but the other areas of Mexico City, the areas that you probably never see. And that's one of the things that Tony is just fantastic at and brilliant at, is discovering and getting beneath the surface. Going into Neza and going into the AFI, you know, nobody's been into the AFI like we've been in. We've been in and photographed it all. They've been just fantastic. And that's the Tony Scott, you know, he gets you in.
It's been a challenge working in Mexico City. I mean, I like the city. It's you know, visually rich and has a lot happening that way. But it's very difficult. It's very congested. It's just difficult to maneuver and get around and get things done quickly. And our local crew is great. They have a lot of experience. But you know, as any time Hollywood goes anywhere, it's, you know, they expect everybody to react and have the ability to be Hollywood as well.
Once we selected the locations, we had to then start to try to get the authorities to help us. And Mexico is a new democracy, and it's very in love with democracy. So Mexico City has been divided into 17 different mini-states, and each one has a governor, and each one's from a different party. And then there's a government on top of that. So it became this labyrinth to find who was in charge, who to contact, and, you know, it's not like the old days where you used to call the president, you know, or go see him, and then one phone call was fixed. It was very, you know, it's been very difficult that way.
One of the biggest production challenges on the film was trying to get a neighborhood to agree to let us to blow up a car. You know, Denzel in one of the scenes takes a rocket launcher and fires into a convoy that's approaching. And that meant the controlling of the intersection for a couple of days, huge fireball and special effects. So trying to find that location that worked creatively for Tony, and he wanted it a busy intersection. We had to find a busy intersection that we could control.
Tougher ones have been like shooting there's a exterior of a club that Denzel is going in to find Dakota. You know, normally on a regular schedule you'd have 2 or 3 days to getting in there, and then the interiors, and then a day or whatever coming out, and then maybe a night where you just do the explosion. And on our schedule, we have to do the going in, the coming out, all the dialogue scenes, and the explosion in one night. So that was very challenging. We shot, I don't know, maybe 15 cameras on that, including me handing 60mm cameras to people in the last second when you shoot it, you know, and just sending, you know, PAs or video technicians with cameras. So, and then that coupled with, you know, cameras on rooftops blocks and blocks away, and dolly shots with people in the foreground, and many cameras in fireboxes, and, you know, a lot of coordination. And that was all done, you know, from about 5:30 a.m. to 6:30 when the light started coming up and we blew the building up. Still a little bit of light coming up, so it's a lot of pressure on days like that. You know, we are shooting a film with a major actor, so it takes time for, you know, blocking, rehearsing, and setting up. So it was a tight day, to say the least. There.
What a night.
Tony is the hardest working person on the crew, bar none. He sleeps 3 to 4 hours a night and expects from his circle of people who are around him to work at that level and to be that dedicated and that determined to achieve his vision and his goal at all costs, whether that means, you know, going to the president and asking for a favor, or getting on your knees to a city council person, or, you know, making something appear out of customs that's impossible to do. That's what's demanded, actually.
Yesterday was a tough day. Today's a little easier, I hope.
Still got a lot to shoot, as usual.
Working on a Tony Scott film is it's great. There are many challenges. I think the biggest challenge is your physical condition, which I must admit, I love, adore, because he taps areas within you that you never knew you had. And that's what it's all about. Because if they were all the same, you'd never move on.
Roll cameras.
He wants it all for the camera. And you know, he's so visual that his demands are great, but ultimately what's in the frame is all that matters. And he gets a very full frame, and he gets incredibly interesting things. So even though it's a big demand for us in production, it is a great thing to watch.
The visual approach of the film has changed somewhat from when we started. In the beginning, we were referencing films like City of God and some kind of rougher-looking independent films that, you know, were a little more run-and-gun than what both Tony and I are accustomed to. So we kind of used that as a framework for this film, and as we started scouting and putting the film together, we kind of shifted gears a little bit and transitioned back into something more traditional storytelling for the beginning of the film. throughout the course of the film, we will incorporate different photographic techniques and things and begin to segue. So in the second half of the film, you'll begin to see some different photographic styles.
When I was considering doing the movie, I do always shoot commercials, and I started to experiment with ways of trying to use technique to identify emotion and the internal workings of characters like Denzel's character, because this movie is really seen, you know, through the eyes and ears of Denzel Washington, of Creasy.
Peter!
The technique is something, you know, in this day and age, everybody's going to digital and going to, you know, special effects houses and stuff, and our technique was we used a 1910 hand crank camera, you know, so we went the opposite way. You know, it doesn't feel like it's 1910, it feels like documentary, it feels very real. You think, fuck, I'm right in the middle of something which is really coming down.
It's based on, you know, traditional hand cranking, which is, you know, a camera with a crank on the side that, you know, in the past, a man was paid for his ability to keep the camera going at 24 frames per second. And what we're doing, and it's funny because we both shot a lot of hand crank independently. You know, I shot a lot of it before I met Tony and then worked with him. We did a few commercials hand crank. And what we're doing in this film is we're taking it to another level. And I'm using multiple exposures, like two, three, four, five exposures at any given time on certain sequences. So literally rolling the film forward, backward, different speeds. Just coming up with, some techniques that kind of reflect the tension and emotional quality of Denzel's character. The scene where Dakota gets kidnapped is, for me, an incredibly disturbing scene.
The sequence was designed so when he gets a sense of what's coming down, we let time stand still. So we actually stretch time, and it's almost that we're inside his head, we get inside Creasy's head.
We set it up visually so that all of a sudden, you know, we see, you know, two police cars pulling and block a road here, another couple over here, and then Zell begins to see some of the pieces.
And he drives down there, which is good. Remember, I'm going to...
But I think the important thing for the stunt guy is that I see him stop and begin to reverse, exactly. Rather than he's in the motion of reversing.
No, he should be, he should have his foot on the pedal, and as Victor, you land and you see him, then he should go.
Yes, right.
At the moment he realizes something is happening, we did a couple photographic techniques where we begin to dolly around him 360 degrees, and he begins to look at the world around him every direction. And then we go into this, what we call a merry-go-round, where the camera's on one side and he's on the other, so the camera and he are spinning together.
So it's like he's whirlwinding, not knowing what to do or which way to go.
Action, B. Great, that's great luck, man, excellent. Action, B.
Okay, I'm gonna go again,
We took a 435, Harry 435 camera, and I mounted on a 90 degree angle and make the shutter, open the shutter on the camera so it creates a streaking effect. So that as the world has kind of gone by, it begins to streak and blur. And so that sets up the whole thing for the kidnapping.
At the same time, we did hand crank cameras. So it's a very sort of strange, stuttered action. So you get a sense that you're absorbed inside his mind and you're absorbed inside his problem.
We set it up in a definite way psychologically, so you know, as a character, he's beginning to see his world and the fear in his own mind.
And I always do storyboards. My storyboards are my way of exercising my ideas and my homework, you know, so storyboards. No, it's like painting. It's like painting pictures, you know, and you get a sense of who your cast is, what your cars are, and what the location's like, what the sound's like. So it's trying to build an overall audiovisual experience.
I use reversal stock, which is stock, which I call heightens reality. It makes the colors that more vivid. It makes the whites burn more, the blacks darker. And then we did what they call cross process, which is another technical thing you do to the film. So you got hand crank, reversal stock, cross process. Then we did it in a helicopter over Mexico City, so it makes Mexico City look beautiful and fucked up and dangerous. Then you think, damn, what acid is this guy on, you know? But it's in a great way, just a fresh way of, you know, nothing's original. You know, guys have been, you know, even in the last 10 years, you know, I did Hand Crank for United Airways in black and white, I did Hand Crank for BMW, but it goes back to Nine Inch Nails, it goes back to their early videos, Closer to God, you know, they did it then. But people didn't, other than just using it as a visual trick, for the first time I think I was able to take it and use it as a way of a visual of telling a story.
Visually for that, we wanted to make it, you know, seem like a very, like a situation we're in now in a park or something, very kind of normal, day to day.
It's a perfect location because it's a beautiful square. And so I know I can smell it and hear it, you know, in terms of the piano resonating across the square. And the first location we chose on the far side of the square, we chose in October when we came back in a month ago. All the green had come in. We had no light in there, so we moved it to the south end of the square here so we could shoot east and we had sunlight all day.
One of the biggest things with Tony is light. Everything revolves around the sun and light, windows, door openings, and everything is played against light. And I've learned so much from Tony from this because he just knows how to handle it.
So when Tony shoots, he has like six cameras going at once. Like there's one on me, one on Denzel, one wide, one on both of us. And just like finds little things to zoom in on, important things.
Back to her.
Still rolling. We have a few cameras here. We've got a few sound cameras, a couple of high-speed ARRI cameras. We're shooting with Panavision XLs, the smaller ones for maneuverability on the sound, ARRI 435s for high-speed, and then we've got two or three 16-millimeter cameras as well that we're also incorporating into these photographic techniques. And we have the two hand cranks, so we have a little more cameras than the studio is happy about, but we're also using them every day on a daily basis. So we shoot a lot of film, and we shoot all of our cameras all the time. Multiple cameras is just insane. You try to keep everything on a certain axis of light and action, but inevitably what happens is some cameras end up facing each other and you've got a lot of stuff where you've got things that are challenged, you know, or compromised by light or eye lines or things. And so the problem is by facilitating with a lot of cameras, you get a lot done, you have a lot of match action, you're getting performances as they happen, but then all of a sudden you may not have the best light, you may not have, you know, you may be a little more profile on a close-up or something than you need to be. Or so there's give and take when you use multiple cameras. Outside of that, it's a nightmare. Different film stocks, different exposures, different filters.
Well, nine camera Tony, he's a real artist, you know. He's a painter first, and he paints beautiful canvases, and he has wonderful ideas, cinematic ideas, and half the time I don't know what the heck it is he's doing with all these cameras, but I'm inspired, and I'm also, you know, getting an education.
Tony picked this absolutely amazing location on a volcano. In this area we're at today, just outside of Pueblo here, and it's just a stunning location that there's a very remote highway in the middle of nowhere with a bridge that goes over it. And in the background there is this amazing volcano that kind of signifies the magnitude of this, you know, of the scene and of the Denzel's character and his ability as a man to trade himself for, you know, this little girl. So it's a pretty incredible scene, and we had mixed light and rain and sun and thunder and lightning, and yesterday skies parted and the volcano blew, and everything happened in 2 days shooting this small scene, you know, powerful scene, and it was pretty amazing. It was just emotionally impactful, you know, shooting it and kind of being there, you know.
It's one of those weird stories that just, it worked out. You know, he was meant to direct it. It took a long time. I mean, Tony's first involvement with this project was 20 years ago. And my first involvement was 13 years ago. So it's, you know, for a lot of people, for Arnon, for Tony, for me, you know, it's a many year odyssey to get here.
I think what's unique about this movie is it's a big movie and it's not shy about what it's saying. A lot of big budget films are not really saying anything because they don't want to disturb anyone and they don't want to like freak anyone out and, you know, they're not political, they're just like blah. Whereas I feel like this movie, even with the hero and the story, it's taking him to a very dark place and you're not quite sure whether you like what you see, whether you agree with it or whether you hate it or whether you're going to throw up or what your response is going to be.
Creasy has reached a point at the beginning of the film where he thinks that everything is in vain, that nothing matters and nothing counts. And by the end, he realizes that he was wrong and that, nothing is in vain. That the struggle of life, whatever form it takes, leads somewhere and that it's not futile.
It's a story about people, normal people, struggling, facing obstacles in their lives. The sanctity of life, the preciousness of family, when you screw with any of that.
I think there's a sort of a spiritual arc. I think he gets back in touch with himself and his soul and his spirit, and you're never too far gone, you know, as far as that character's concerned. You're never too lost. You never reach a depth of despair that you can't climb out of. You know, there are angels out there, and you just don't know when one is near, you know. You have to open your eyes to see that, and sometime it could be right next to you. And this little girl who seems to be, at first to him, just a pain in the neck, little girl asks 1,000 questions is profound and really helps him to come to grips with his past and helps him to give the ultimate sacrifice for her.
It's not about sentimentality, it's about an honesty. In a really emotional situation, emotional when you have kids and these kids are taken, or what it does to you.